Just what are these enemy creatures in They Live? Well, based on the technology that they use and the interstellar travel later in the film, the easiest answer is that they are aliens. But there's a lot more going on than that. For one thing, they look a bit like insects with those lidless bug eyes. And that is a traditional feature of how aliens have been depicted in science fiction movies since the 1960s. The eyes are the most dehumanized feature of these creatures, and so, being that eyes are the most emotionally expressive feature of the human anatomy, these bug eyes convey that these creatures do not feel as we do, if they even feel at all. If they have emotions, then those emotions are alien to us. These physiological differences in eye structure are a major factor that decreases human empathy for insects and arachnids, and so that seems to be the basis of why a lot of science fiction features alien invaders with bug eyes. The next most emotionally expressive part of the human face is the mouth, and so the aliens lack lips, leaving them with a bared teeth appearance that conveys hostility. Again, there's a crossover with bugs that typically have mandibles and no lips, but of course these aren't mandibles, they're very human-looking teeth. And combined with the bony rims around the eye sockets, this makes the alien face very reminiscent of a human skull. So as well as the emotional insect theme, we have a theme of death and decay. And this is certainly thematic. A creature with no lips probably wouldn't be able to make a lot of the sounds necessary to produce decipherable human language. Try talking with your lips stretched back. I suppose we could argue that some birds can mimic human voices, but we still recognise bird imitation voices as not human. The face of death metaphor is absolutely intended because the script mostly describes the enemy as ghouls and only uses the word alien occasionally. The script also says that when this one opens its mouth, we can see through the back of its head. Not easy to shoot that, though, with the absence of CGI in 1988. It would require an animatronic puppet. Although the word ghoul conveys a variety of monster types in horror literature, They Live script narrows this meaning down by also describing the enemy as the living dead and as zombies. We also have the coloration of the enemy. Even though they're mostly seen in black and white, their flesh looks like skinless bone with bits of muscle tissue and tendons. At the end of the film, the coloration of blood red and bluish bone furthers the appearance of them being rotting corpses. And this one just sits there, lifeless, while others comment on its presence. John Narda, the lead character, certainly sees the zombie interpretation.
She looks like a regular person, doesn't she, huh? Put him back on, formaldehyde face, that's what we got.
That's enough out of you.
Formaldehyde is a deathly substance hazardous to human health. Something else that sort of contradicts the alien interpretation of these creatures is that they tend to use Earth-manufactured weapons, no laser guns or anything like that. In the original short story, the lead character did acquire and use an alien weapon, but the comic adaptation replaced this with human-manufactured firearms, and that came before the movie came out, so it seems director John Carpenter decided to go with that. Anyway, it seems from all these details that there's a duality in They Live's enemy creatures. Yes, they're aliens, but they're also the living dead, zombie versions of ourselves. This fits strongly with the religious aspect of the movie. The rebels operate initially from a church, and the preacher is one of their leading members. So it makes sense that the enemy have an undead ghoul aspect to them. And a lot of Carpenter's films, horror films, basically were supernatural stories involving ghoulish monsters. In fact, science fiction and horror monsters are close kindred generally. The audience's general belief in religion, and thus the supernatural, used to give werewolves, vampires, witches, and ghouls an element of plausibility over the centuries. But then advancements of biological understanding quickly cast massive doubts on those fictional enemies, and in place of the supernatural came mutants and aliens. But essentially, the psychological role of alien, mutant, and supernatural enemies are the same. They're all monsters from our own psyche. This is an aspect of They Live that I very much like. It's unusual. However, it creates a core contradiction. How can they live if they're dead? But the contradiction goes a lot further than that. The film overtly presents the enemy as having power over humans, both in perception and in terms of economic and social status.
It's easy for you to say you got the promotion.
So it'll come, all right? Just don't worry about it.
But lots of details suggest that they are just as enslaved as the human characters, perhaps even more so. A major clue is that after Narda sees all the newspapers and magazines through his magic glasses and discovers that those publications are just pages of simple enslavement commands, one of the zombified aliens walks in and buys one of the newspapers. We can see that the very paper he buys contains the blunt messages, conform and do not question authority. Why would this ghoul want to expose itself to the same enslavement messages as the human subjects? I can see no other logic here except to conclude that the humans and their enemy controllers are seeing the same illusionary articles. Yet the woman ghoul here states,
"I've got one that can see."
So it seems there's a sort of double-think delusion on their part. They see humans as being enslaved to them, yet they don't see how they are enslaved themselves. Sounds far out, doesn't it? But bear with me. There are multiple supporting factors for this interpretation. In the original short story and comic book adaptation, the lead character who rebels is revealed at the end of the story to be one of the monsters himself, but he didn't realise it. He thought he was human. He's actually given a hypnotic command over the phone by his local police chief to have a heart attack and to die at 8 o'clock in the morning because he's too old. And despite waking up and seeing the monsters around him, he does actually die from a heart attack as commanded. In other words, the monsters were slaves as well in the story and comic versions. John Carpenter completely dropped the ending for the film version, opting to keep the hero human. This was almost certainly to maintain audience identification with the lead character, even after the movie ends. But nevertheless, Carpenter was aware of the mutual enslavement concept, and so this is likely to have manifested in his film on a more subtle level, even if he didn't consciously intend it to. The transformation of monster appearances also occurred across the three formats. In the original short story, they're described as reptilian with four eyes. It's good that Carpenter didn't go for the reptile look because it had already been done a few years before in the TV series V. In the comic version, the reptilian creatures were replaced by very silly-looking slime balls with dozens of eyes. And very interestingly, when the lead character dies at the end of the comic, his face morphs into a multi-eyed slime monster, and then into a distinctly human skull with just two eye sockets. This is a strong indication of the slime blob appearance being an illusion itself, a symbolic representation of evil and corruption. So back to the movie. We have a monster who exposes himself to subliminal message publications, and we have monsters that socially interact with humans on the level of friendship.
She didn't even go to Lamaze class. I told her, for yourself and for the baby. Go!
Why would they socially interact on a sort of daily personal basis like this if they considered humans as inferior species well below themselves? The short story makes a point of having Nada travel on a subway and discover that the aliens don't travel on there because they're probably too good for it. But all three versions of the story contradict the class by species message by featuring human and monster sexual interactions. In the novel and comic, the lead turns out to be a monster, but also has a human fiancé. And in the comic and film versions, a random interspecies sexual encounter is shown at the end.
Hey, what's wrong, baby?
The one in the movie doesn't seem to be a one-night stand either, because the subliminal message, marry and reproduce, is written on the wall behind her. It doesn't say have casual sex with strangers. So, can these two make half-human, half-monster babies or what? The crucial roles of law enforcement and media propaganda we would expect to be exclusively conducted by aliens to prevent infiltration by human rebels. Yet, here's a human cop. And in the TV studio at the end, people run out after the hypnotic spell is broken, indicating that these TV station employees weren't just people who'd actually sold out to help the aliens. The monsters also convey more of a hive mind mentality than their human slaves. Here they walk and talk in sync. Cop versions of them march together like Marines. The concept of zombies itself is often used to represent people who are either lacking in perception or are mind controlled. Hence, hypnotized and sleepy states are often called zombie states. And those big bug eyes make the enemies look like they're drugged, spaced out, hypnotized. This one transfixed to the TV. So the big question all this raises for me is, are the monster enemies even more enslaved than the humans? Being that they have high-paying job positions, it's arguable that they are in some ways more dependent on the system. They've got more to lose, whereas our mostly homeless rebels have already hit near rock bottom, so the only way is up. Actually, in the short story and comic, there is even a homeless drunk monster on the street. A monster at the lowest rung of the social ladder. So much for the class war framing. Only Carpenter's version lacks that drunk monster, and his is the more politicised story. Last two related issues on this subject. First, the character Holly, who works as assistant program director at the TV station which sends out the hypnotic signal. She's doing well for herself financially and lives up in the hills of Hollywood. Yet the actress has uniquely coloured eyes that are reminiscent of the metallic glazed look in the monster's eyes. And she's not wearing contact lenses here, that's the natural colour of this actress's eyes. She is human when seen through the magic glasses, yet she turns out to be a traitor. A pretty cold one as well. So I suspect she was cast because of those stunning eyes that visually suggest her to be some sort of human-alien hybrid. And last curious detail, one of the subliminal commands that appears many times in the movie simply states, "No thought." That's quite vague. To have absolutely no thought would be equivalent to being a zombie. And as I stated earlier, there's a big question of whether the alien ghouls are equally susceptible to these hypnotic messages up on the advertisement boards. So, overall, the enemies are aliens in the literal sense, but symbolically the details mostly point toward them being spaced out, bug-eyed zombies who are just as psychologically controlled as the humans of the story. You've been listening to Rob Ager, thanks for watching. This video is actually a small segment of a much larger study of They Live that I'm currently putting together, so keep an eye on my website, collativelearning.com, because that video should be available in the next week or so. It won't be here on YouTube, and it's probably going to be about at least a 90-minute video. Be sure to check out my other film analysis videos here on YouTube and on my website. If you like John Carpenter stuff, then I've got videos on The Thing. I've got some of them here on YouTube and some of them on my site. You might want to check those out, and lots of other horror and science fiction films and other genres as well. Go check them all out. The links are in the video description below. Bye-bye.